I don't need it, don't want it, but the whiskey keeps me haunted. It keeps calling me, and I can't lose it, can't hide it. It rattles down inside me. It keeps calling me.
I was dropped on the earth in the year of the snake. My ma was a nurse and my pa was a fake. He said it was the cold, but she knew it was the shakes. I guess he couldn't hold what he couldn't escape. I dropped out of high school in the 10th grade. Was gonna kill Japs for the US Navy. Picture me Lieutenant Delbert Grady. They wouldn't let me in because my hands were shaky. I started working any job that paid me. I started going with this proper lady. She had me cleaning up the church grounds daily, hoping she could drive me out to make a baby. We lost our first in the year of the rat. I lost my shirt when Maz took that. I cracked the egg and the yolk came red. If you can't break through, you're gonna break your head.
I don't need it, don't want it, but the whiskey keeps me haunted. It keeps calling me, calling me.
It keeps calling me, calling me.
And I can't lose it, can't hide it. It rattles down inside me. It keeps calling me, calling me.
My soul was left and moved to Estes Park. Laid to rest the thing I did, the darkness. I worked hard to make a brand new start. Kept close to the trailer park, far from the bar. In the year of the tiger, Louise was born. I was pulling double shifts at the dry goods store. Was clean as a whistle, but still dirt poor. Was good with one kid, but she wanted one more. When Louise was two, Lisa was due. She lit the whole room like the hole in her roof. My mom flew out for the big debut. She stayed in the park till she died of the flu. I stopped at the Dark Horse after the wait. When I came home at three, Betty smelled a mistake. I awoke in a cell with my head full of ache and remained in the fog till the year of the dog.
I don't need it, don't want it, but the whiskey keeps me haunted. It keeps calling me, hey. And I can't lose it, can't hide it. It rattles down inside me. It keeps calling me.
When I hit rock bottom at last, I was saved from the grave by a broken gasket. Picking up trash on Route 34, I came upon a man in a broken down Ford. I knew just what to do cause I'd seen it before. I used my canteen to fill his radiator. I brought him into town to look it over with Mel, who told us it would take a few days to get the part. I drove him up the pass to the Overlook Hotel, where repairs were being done before the winter got started. Oh, what luck for your friend D. Grady. The man so relieved was inclined to repay me. He noticed I was living in the back of my Studebaker, offered me a job as the wintertime caretaker. Hustled back to town to tell Betty and the girls. She wouldn't let me in, she wouldn't have it anymore. I swore that it was true, I promised her the world. And I knew there was a chance cause she listened through the door. Please baby baby, please baby baby, please. Please baby baby, things got better before they got worse. I was made for this place like a corpse for a hearse. I turned down the boiler each night like clockwork. I cleaned every station from tool shed to desk clerk. Seemed like we were finally home, with some fresh mountain air to breathe life in the bone. And nothing but time, no TV or phone. Should've known that the wife couldn't leave it alone. She started real subtle, just little observations, wondering why we didn't get the best accommodations. Wondering if I should've asked for better compensation. Perhaps that Mr. Omen guy had known my reputation. The storm rolled in, my wits wore thin. With the girls indoors, there was double the din. And Betty doing nothing about the trouble they're in. Always trying to get one over on me, dressing like twins. And one night they took the joke too far. Betty found a whiskey bottle underneath the bar, and next to with a half-smoked bag cigar. She threw them in my face, left a 4-inch scar. I couldn't get my mind right after that night. I started seeing voices, I started hearing lights. I dreamt I was a minotaur running through the maze. I woke up on the second floor banging on the door.
I don't need it, don't want it, but the whiskey keeps me haunted. It keeps calling me, and I can't lose it, can't hide it. It rattles down inside me. It keeps calling me, calling.
Before long, I was sleeping in the lounge. Betty said it wasn't safe to keep a gun around. I startled her awake one night, ripping at her gown. And the girls were hearing whispering and radio sounds. One night by the fire, while she taught me to read, Louise stopped my lesson to tell me we should leave. I want you to like it here, I tried to reset her. I wish that we could stay here forever and ever. She wandered upstairs as I chopped up the kindling. Stopped mid-swing when the front desk phone rang. Those lines have been down for at least 2 months. But here was this call from a Bob T. Watson. Grady, do you know what your daughter's in? Did you happen to wonder where your matches have been? The management feels that they lack discipline. Perhaps you're not so adept in correction. The next thing I remember is Betty screaming. I opened my eyes to see my girl's hacked to pieces. Before I could react, the wall exploded to my right. She glared down the barrel while she put me in the sight. I crawled around the corner as she tore down the hall. I slid on the blood and a chair broke my fall when she bore down on me with the shotgun raised. Every clock in the overlook rang out its praise. She startled and dropped the gun within my reach. I snatched it up and fired it into her teeth. And then it was done, my duty's complete. The silence was torn by the voice of Bob T. Grady, I must say I'm rather impressed. You've proven yourself to work well under stress. But before we can offer you the year-round employment, you'll have to get downstairs and shut off the boiler. It's hell getting down there with one mangled leg, but I'm a hard-working man, yeah, that's what the man said. And with all those bodies stacked safely in the beds, I swallow both barrels and I open my head.
Colorado Lounge, the lift boy called out. Congratulations on the new job, sir, he shouted. A big-chested bald man wrangled my arm. I spoke with a hint of that old southern charm. Everyone is waiting, come, come, Mr. Grady. The manager's been very pleased with you lately. Outside the gold room, I read the big sash. The overlooker welcomes the Grady's at last. He handed me a bottle and he called to the crowd. Said, we make this man the bartender. What do you think? I froze for a moment and I looked out at Betty. Her smile was as dead as my urge to drink.